everyone, and welcome to the first part of the 9.0 Connects webinar series on practical aspects of signal integrity. My name is Tom Cassidy, and I'm a senior engineer at 9.0 Connects. I have a master's of electrical engineering from Rice University, and I've been working in the field for more than 35 years. My goal for this webinar is not to teach signal integrity per se, but to present different PCB designs that showcase the various aspects of signal integrity and how they apply to real-world problems. And along the way, we will, of course, learn some of the core concepts relating to the field of signal integrity. My plan for the webinar is to first give a high-level overview of the field of signal integrity and why it is becoming so important. I will then present and analyze a series of PCB layouts, showing how we can use the results to find and prevent potential design problems. In part two of the series, I will present some of the more advanced layout paradigms and then culminate with a finished FPGA-based DDR3 design. I also hope to touch on some power analysis topics if time permits. Okay, at this point, I'd like to do a polling question. The question is basically, why are you attending this webinar? I'd like to know if you're just curious, if you've heard about signal integrity and might want to use it yourself, if you're familiar with signal integrity but just want to brush up, or if you know you have signal integrity issues and you're looking for a solution. It looks like a fair number of you are familiar and just want to brush up. Well, that's great. Well, hopefully I can do that for you. So I'm going to go ahead and continue with the webinar. I would like to start the webinar off with a quote from a book called Signal and Power Integrity Simplified by Eric Bogatin. And the quote says, there are two kinds of engineers, those who have signal integrity problems and those who will. Now, this quote isn't really referring to ignorance on the part of the engineer, but rather to the evolution of the industry itself. And what I mean by this is that even if your designs are working fine now, the inevitable march of progress will eventually cause your designs to reach the point where signal integrity issues can no longer be ignored. So when I say signal integrity, what am I talking about? To put it simply, signal integrity refers to the issues that are caused by the interconnects between components rather than the operation of the actual components themselves. For a PCB designer, these interconnects obviously refer to the copper traces. In addition to the properties of the actual trace itself, there are several other factors that affect the integrity of the signal. These factors include the thickness and material of the dielectric layers, which layer the trace is actually on, and the location and properties of any other objects that might be in proximity to that trace. Now, all of this sounds interesting, but as we all know, simulation and analysis tend to cost time and money, so why would we even consider doing it? A September 2018 Lifecycle Insights report found that a company will often do an average of almost 3 respins per project, and the cost of these respins is an incredible $28,000. So based on these numbers, it sure makes sense to spend a little more time and money up front when the cost of making changes is still relatively low. So it seems that applying signal integrity analysis makes sense from an economic perspective, but how exactly does it help us with the design process? The short answer is that it helps us make better engineering decisions. As we all know, engineering, much like politics, is all about compromise. We often need to make changes in one part of the design in order to get another part to work. But how do we know how these changes are going to affect the overall design? Signal integrity analysis can help figure this out. Another way signal integrity analysis can help is in the optimization of the design. In the past, we were able to use best practice techniques to help us make various design and layout decisions. Some examples of this include how to space our sensitive traces, the best way to perform length tuning, and so on. However, the real world seems to be conspiring against us, and these techniques just don't seem to cut it anymore. This conspiracy results in ever-increasing demands being made on the product and its design cycle. Examples include decreasing the size and cost of the board, improving reliability, making it easier to manufacture, and reducing the time to market. And on top of all of this, the design is often expected to work right the very first time. So we really need to be able to do everything we can to improve the design during the layout phase itself. And nowadays, this means applying simulation and signal integrity analysis techniques to find potential design flaws and fix them as soon as possible. As a side note, I'd like to mention that for the purposes of this webinar, I'm combining the field of power integrity, or PDN analysis, under the same umbrella as signal integrity, even though it is often treated as its own separate subject. And there is often a third topic associated with signal integrity called electromagnetic compatibility. However, I will also not be addressing this topic in my webinar. Okay, at this point, I'd like to do polling question number two. And the question is, what SI simulation tools are you currently using? And it looks like there's not a whole lot of signal integrity simulation going on out there, which is kind of what we expected, and glad to hear you're attending this webinar. Go ahead and continue back with the webinar. We're going to start things off with the simplest and most ideal routing situation that I could come up with. Essentially, it consists of two chips connected by a single trace routed on the same layer as the components. U1, seen on the left side, is a Xilinx FPGA, which is part of the Zynq 7000 series. On the right side is U2, an ISSI DDR3 chip, which is representative of a typical 16-bit SDRAM chip used in many onboard or embedded memory designs. And in between the two chips is a single trace, which I connected between the data bus pins. I chose the data bus because they are typically already terminated by the chips themselves, using what is known as on-die termination, or ODT. This means I don't have to worry about terminating the line with an external device, making the routing even cleaner. The board itself consists of a very simple two-layer stackup, since I really just need to have a signal and return path for the kind of simulations I'll be performing. At this point, I'm not really worried about having to power the chips yet. I have also optimized the materials and the routing dimensions to give me an exact 40-ohm signal-ended impedance trace. In this case, I'm using a 15-mil-wide trace, which matches the diameter of the pin pads. I am also using a dielectric thickness of exactly 5.961 mils, which is not something you would normally find out in the wild, but in this case, it gives me the exact impedance measurement I'm looking for. At this point, I would like to say a word about the workflow that I'm using to generate my data. The astute observer may have noticed that I'm doing my layouts using Altium Designer, and in particular, version 19 of that program. I then export the resulting design into the ODB++ file format in order to import it into the Cadence Sigourney simulation universe. The first step of the actual simulation process is to import the physical design into Cadence PowerSI. This very powerful program performs EM modeling based on the geometry and the composition of the PCB using both 2D and 3D field solvers. I'll talk more about these concepts later. While it is PowerSI that gives us the data we need to analyze the PCB based on its physical dimensions, we need to use Cadence System SI in order to get the data that is more related to the functionality of the design. This data includes such things as signal waveforms, eye diagrams, and so on. It is System SI that utilizes component models such as SPICE and IBIS in order to get higher level information about the operation of the design. Okay, at this point, we need to delve into some of the signal integrity and simulation concepts we'll need in order to correctly generate our data and to interpret the results in a meaningful manner. The first concept I would like to introduce is that of signal bandwidth. As we see here, signal bandwidth does not relate to the clock speed or communications bandwidth, but rather to the frequency spectrum associated with the transition of a signal from one voltage level to another. Indeed, this is one of the most basic and important concepts in the field of signal integrity. Any and all issues related to signal integrity arise from the transition of a signal. It is only when a signal is changing that we get signal integrity issues. As an interesting side note, this means that you can have just as many signal integrity problems with a 100 megahertz clock as you can with a 1 gigahertz clock. This is because a slow clock that has fast transitions can be just as dangerous as a fast clock that has fast transitions. So what does it mean to talk about the bandwidth of a transition, and why do we really have to worry about it at all? With apologies to the math purists out there, I'm going to reduce an entire field of study to this simple statement. In order to have a sharp signal transition, you need to have high frequency components to the signal. If you lose these higher frequency components, your signal no longer has a sharp edge. Conversely, if we know what transition speed we can get away with, we can disregard the higher frequencies needed for these sharper signals, thus getting rid of a host of signal integrity problems associated with the unnecessary high frequencies. In the abstract, signal bandwidth is all well and good, but how do we know what it actually is? How do we determine what the frequency range is that we are concerned about when the only information we really have are things like the transition times of the signal? Fortunately, we can use a simple rule of thumb provided by Mr. Bogatin to come up with the answer. If we know the rise time in nanoseconds, we can calculate the approximate bandwidth with the following formula. Since our example is based on DDR3, and typical rise times for DDR3 signals are in the 0.25 nanosecond range, using this formula, we would calculate our target bandwidth to be about 1.4 gigahertz. Rounding up to a bandwidth limit of about 2 gigahertz should therefore be sufficient for our simulations. However, since I'm trying to demonstrate overall signal integrity issues rather than just make a working design, I'm going to simulate up to 20 gigahertz so we can see some of the high order effects in our examples. Now that we know the signal bandwidth we're interested in, let's go ahead and simulate the PCB. As I mentioned earlier, I create the layout in Altium Designer, export it to ODB++, and import it into the Cadence PowerSI simulation tool. And by using PowerSI, I am able to generate a mathematical model of the actual PCB itself. This brings us to our second signal integrity concept, that of behavioral models. A behavioral model is essentially a mathematical model of the PCB that allows us to determine the effects that the physical board will have on the signals as they propagate from the transmitter to the receiver. In the world of signal integrity analysis, behavioral models usually take the form of something called an S parameter, which is short for scatter parameters. This is an analysis tool borrowed from RF and microwave engineering, and as such, brings with it some rather unusual baggage. However, I'll try to gloss over the tricky stuff as much as possible for this webinar. S parameters essentially model the way the PCB affects sine wave signals over a range of frequencies. This is why we had to decide on the signal bandwidth in order to know which frequency range we needed to simulate. A system-level simulation tool, such as Cadence System SI, will then use these S parameters to model the PCB as it performs its functional simulations. In addition, graphing the S parameters in various different ways can also tell us some interesting facts about the PCB without the need for further simulation. To demonstrate this, here are the results of the simulation of our ideal layout. In this graph, we see that the S parameters are representing the signal amplitude as a function of frequency. Thus, the y-axis goes from 0 to 1, with 1 indicating 100% amplitude, and the x-axis showing the frequency range. The red line at the top represents the percentage of the signal passing through the trace. As we see, at a frequency of 0, or DC, there is 100% transmission. This makes sense, since copper traces are pretty good at conducting DC currents. You can also see that as the frequency increases, there is more and more attenuation of the signal. This indicates that, for various reasons, higher frequency signals have a harder time getting through the PCB traces. The blue line at the bottom represents the amount of the signal that is reflected back to the transmitter. This is a slightly harder concept to grasp, but essentially it is an indicator of the impedance of the trace, along with any mismatches that might be present. Once again, at DC, there is no reflection occurring, while at higher frequencies, the reflections start to come and go. In addition, the periodic nature of these reflections is an indicator of various resonant conditions along the trace. While overall, this is a pretty interesting graph to look at, if you recall, we decided that for the purposes of a DDR3 design, we are really only interested in frequencies up to about 2 gigahertz. Therefore, we are really only concerned with the behavior of the PCB in the frequency ranges at or below 2 gigahertz, as indicated by the yellow line here. As you can see, the S parameters are pretty boring below 2 GHz, which tells me that the PCB is going to be pretty well behaved within these frequencies. However, one thing I don't have an intuitive grasp of is just how good or bad these numbers are. While S parameter graphs can provide very useful information, how do we know what constitutes an acceptable level of attenuation? And remember, we're working in the frequency domain here, so it's difficult to know if a 10% attenuation at 1 GHz is going to be good or bad. It would definitely be more helpful to see this information presented as waveforms in the time domain, since that's where we humans tend to live, at least most of the time. To do this, we need to use a system-level simulator such as Cadence System SI. This tool will use the S parameter model of the PCB along with models of the actual components themselves in order to generate waveforms in the time domain. Here we see three blocks representing the three simulation objects: the FPGA memory controller, the DDR3 memory device, and the PCB model itself. Each of these blocks has a mathematical model associated with it. The PCB block, of course, has the S parameters we generated from PowerSI. The active components utilize a model known as IBIS, which stands for Input-Output Buffer Information Specification. This is essentially a mathematical model of how just the I/O pins themselves operate, rather than a complete model of the device itself. Once I've entered these models into System SI and set up simulation parameters such as the clock rate, I'm able to generate time domain waveforms of my signals. Note that for this first simulation, I'm using a rather unrealistically slow clock rate in order to focus on the signal transitions. And here we can see that these transitions look pretty good. The red waveform is the voltage at the FPGA driver pin, and the blue waveform is the voltage at the DDR3 memory pin. There is almost no ringing, and the edges are about as sharp at the memory chip as they are at the FPGA. You can also see that there is very little signal delay. One of the nice things about using a simulator is that it lets us play what-if games with our design. My first simulation used a 40-ohm on-die termination in the memory chip. I can easily turn this off in the simulator, and we could see what kind of an effect it will have on my signals. As you can see, the effect is pretty dramatic. We now have a lot of ringing, which is essentially signal reflections from the impedance mismatches at the end of the trace bouncing back and forth. This is a really good demonstration of why you want to terminate your traces correctly. Okay, at this point we now have an ideal routing design and the simulation results in both the frequency and time domains. As I proceed to implement the remaining layout cases, I will compare their simulation results with these baseline simulations in order to demonstrate any new signal integrity effects that may have been caused by the new routing paradigms. My first design case may have been ideal, but it wasn't very realistic. We, of course, cannot route our boards with perfectly straight traces, and therefore we must have bends somewhere. But just how much do these bends affect the integrity of the signals? Bends cause an impedance mismatch on the trace at the location of the bends. This is due to the fact that the geometry of the copper changes at the point of the bend. Impedance mismatches cause signals to reflect, which in turn show up as attenuation and noise on the signal. To minimize this noise, we want to minimize impedance mismatches in the trace. There are three types of bends commonly used for PCB layouts: 45 degrees, 90 degrees, and arcs. In the interest of time, I'm not going to deal with arbitrary angles at this point. As you can see here, I've created three designs in which everything but the bend type is the same. In fact, even the trace length is exactly the same as for my initial ideal routing. Here is the S parameter graph of the first bend type, that of a 90 degree angle. As you can see, it doesn't really look much different than that of our first ideal routing case. To make this comparison easier, I've overlapped the S parameter graph of the ideal case with this new one. We can now see some differences, but as you see, these differences are really only noticeable in the high frequency regions of the graph. In our area of interest, that below 2 GHz, the graphs are virtually identical. Here are the results for the 45 bend case. And here are the results for the arc bend. Not much of a difference, huh? It looks like all three bend types have almost exactly the same behavioral graphs. For an overall comparison, Here is a graph with all of the bend cases overlapping with the ideal route. Other than being slightly different from the ideal case in the upper frequency ranges, it seems pretty obvious that these three types of bends have pretty much the same S parameters. This indicates that they will affect the signal integrity in pretty much exactly the same way. Now let's take a look at the time domain waveforms. As you can see, they also look pretty much exactly the same as the ideal case. I've shown it here in the bottom for comparison. This matches the conclusion we reached from analyzing in the frequency domain. So these results tell us that the bend type just doesn't really affect the signal integrity all that much, at least for signal bandwidths up to the frequency limit of about 2 GHz. And thus we have our first real-world conclusion derived from signal integrity analysis. When doing DDR3 routing, the trace bend type just won't have that much of an effect on the integrity of the signals. You are free to use whatever method works best for your routing design. I would now like to examine the signal integrity effects that occur due to variations in the width of a trace. As we know, the impedance of a trace is governed by its dimensions, and changing these dimensions will affect the impedance and thus affect the integrity of the signal. But once again, we have to ask ourselves just how badly these changes are, and when do we have to be worried? To explore this issue, I've modified my initial ideal route to have a trace length of 32 mils. This will give us some extra room to work with. I then changed the routing to have a wider trace in the middle of the route. Here, the trace width is 45 mils, 3 times the original trace. I did this to emphasize the impedance mismatch for demonstration purposes. Hopefully, you won't do this in the real design. Here are the S parameters of the clean trace, that with a constant width. And here are the parameters of the variable trace width. As you can see, the results are pretty dramatic. We see much more transmission loss in our target frequency range, as well as a lot more reflected energy. However, as I said, this is a pretty dramatic difference in trace width. A more realistic scenario would be something like this, with a trace width going from 15 mils to 25 mils. When we perform our simulations and look at the results, we still see an increase in the transmission loss, but it is not as dramatic. The same can be said for the reflected energy as well. Here, I've overlaid the results from both routing paradigms, that of a constant 15 mil trace versus the one with 25 mil segment in the middle. There seem to be some significant changes, but is this really the case? And how does it look in the time domain? Here are the waveforms from our constant width case, very similar to our original ideal route, which is pretty much what we would expect. The only difference is a slight increase in the signal delay. Here, I've added the waveform for our 25 mil case. Still not really a whole lot of change. There is a little more ringing, but otherwise these transitions are still looking good. Here is a graph that shows just the waveforms at the controller for each of my routing cases. The red waveform is the one with the trace width mismatch. As you can see, there are still some slight changes from the black waveform, which is that of the constant trace width. Interestingly enough, the waveforms seen at the memory chip are almost exactly the same in both cases. This tells us that the impedance mismatches affect the reflected energy more than they do the transmitted energy. However, I should remind you that this is a pretty slow data rate. In the real world, with faster clock rates, even a slight change in the signal transitions can have some dramatic effects. I'll cover this more later when I introduce signal eye diagrams. But for now, we can conclude that slight changes in trace widths only have slight changes to the integrity of the signal. Unless we're right on the hairy edge of our timing or voltage levels, we can live with some width changes without having to worry about them too much. There is the caveat that for tight designs, even small variations can have dramatic effects, so performing a board-level simulation is imperative in these cases. I'd like to start the next design topic off with another signal integrity concept, that of the return current path. For signal integrity analysis, the return current path is just as important as the signal current path. We must take both current paths into account in order to correctly analyze any potential signal integrity issues. As we know, all current flows in a loop, and so the current flowing from the drive circuit to the receiver will need to find its way back to the source. The signal current path will obviously be in the copper trace unique to that signal, but the return current path ideally uses a reference plane located adjacent to the trace. Note that this reference plane does not necessarily need to be a ground plane, it just needs to be a wide piece of copper. In addition to just finding its way back to the driver, the return current for any signal will also want to find the path of lowest impedance. At low frequencies, the return current from a signal is pretty much able to follow whatever path it likes without us worrying much about how it affects the signal integrity. However, at higher frequencies, the return path becomes more critical. For these higher frequency signals, the ideal return path will basically mirror the signal trace, but on the reference plane. Without getting into the physics of the situation, suffice it to say that by having the return current mirror the path of the signal trace, the inductance loop of the signal is minimized, and thus they will have the lowest possible impedance. The corollary of this statement implies that any path that is longer than the one directly mirroring the signal trace will have a higher inductance and thus have more impedance. From a signal integrity point of view, this is a less than ideal situation. Unfortunately, when routing complex and crowded designs, you often have to create many different power planes and sometimes even have additional ground planes as well. Known as split planes, this situation is typically required to support the large number of voltage supply rails that today's devices seem to require. Split planes can also be used to provide isolation for noise or other regulatory issues. Unfortunately, the use of split planes sometimes makes routing impedance-controlled signals even more difficult, since one of the basic tenets of high-speed design is to never have a gap in your return current path. To demonstrate just what kind of effects these gaps or splits may have on the integrity of a signal, I'll go back to my original ideal routing design. Although I mentioned it briefly, I'll point out that there is a solid reference plane on the bottom layer of the board. This acts as the return current path for the signal, and since nothing else is routed nearby and no other currents are present, it's about as good a reference as you're going to get. As you can see in this design, I've added a gap in the reference plane, perpendicular to the route, and about 4 millimeters wide and 8 millimeters high. The gap is represented by the blue dashed rectangle. After running the simulation and generating the S parameters, we see that there is a significant effect caused by this gap, especially at the higher frequency ranges. In fact, there is even a new resonant condition that totally attenuates certain frequencies. Overlapping the S parameters from the ideal case only emphasizes these changes even more. With an S parameter graph looking like this, we can expect the time domain signal to be pretty bad as well, and as you see, it is. You can see this signal now has significant ringing, both in amplitude and duration. In fact, it seems like it's even worse than having mismatched terminations at the end of the trace. And if having a small gap in the return path causes these kind of problems, you can only imagine what would happen if you forced your return current path to go all the way around a split plane. We have now reached another important conclusion. Never, ever, under any circumstances, have a gap in the return path underneath high-speed signals. This also means never route high-speed signals across a split plane. Let's expand a bit on the trace bend concept and explore the signal integrity implications of another common routing paradigm, that of the accordion or trombone trace, which is typically used during length tuning. Here is an example of an accordion trace based on my ideal routing case and having a trace length of 32 millimeters. Layout software typically allows you to set the various parameters associated with these traces, namely the spacing, the height, and the corner type. These dimensions are usually chosen to meet fabrication specifications, but how can these parameters also affect the integrity of the signal? We have shown that the bend type does not really matter from a signal integrity point of view. As you see here, I went ahead and used arc bends since Altium lets me add them just as easily, and I personally like the way they look. So other than the bend type, the only other parameters we can examine are the spacing and the amplitude of the accordion. These essentially define the width and length of the parallel traces, as shown here in green arrows. This brings us to our next signal integrity concept, that of mutual inductance. Mutual inductance arises when the magnetic fields of a current flow in one trace overlap another copper trace. A changing magnetic field will induce a current in the second trace, thus introducing unwanted noise. And since the magnetic fields are stronger as you get closer, it follows that having the traces close together will have more noise than those that are farther apart. Magnetic fields also have a direction as well as a strength, and are thus known as vector fields. So depending on how the vectors of two overlapping magnetic fields line up, they can either add together and increase the strength of the field, or subtract and reduce the field strength. This is a very important effect, since noise is directly related to the strength of the magnetic field. A common example of this is the magnetic solenoid. In this case, the wires are looped around a center core with a diameter large enough so that the magnetic fields do not overlap the wires on the opposite side of the coil. Since the current is, of course, the same in all of the coils, all of the magnetic field vectors are aligned in the same direction, add together, and thus increase the strength of the magnetic field. However, in the case of an accordion trace, the traces are close enough together that the magnetic fields can overlap. And since the current in each leg is going in the opposite direction, this means that the magnetic field from one leg of the trace will actually decrease the magnetic field around the second trace. This serves to reduce the overall inductance of the trace. So this means that we can no longer depend on just the static inductance calculations based on the geometry of the trace, but must also take into account the interactions of the magnetic fields generated by the signals themselves. And remember, the strength of these fields depends directly on both the distance between the traces and the total parallel length. From a signal integrity perspective, reducing the inductance changes the impedance and thus changes the time delay of the signal. This can affect your signal timing because it is no longer just the trace length that is involved in your calculations. So a design based on trace length only may seem to be okay on the drawing board, but might fail in the real world. The only way to come up with a realistic number is to use a 3D field solver simulation tool, such as Cadence Power SI. To demonstrate the signal integrity effects of different accordion dimensions, I've created two design cases, one with a loose accordion and one with tighter dimensions. After simulating both designs, I've plotted the combined S parameters here. As you see, there are enough differences to conclude that the mutual inductance of the narrower accordions is probably changing the integrity of the signal. But the question remains, just how bad are these changes? Let's go to the time domain to find out. As it turns out, the effects on the timing are not very noticeable at all. When I plotted the waveforms of both design cases, they came out to be almost exactly the same, even when I zoomed in tightly to a single pulse. So our conclusion from this is that although tight accordion traces do affect the S parameters of the model, these changes are too slight to affect the timing and the signals typically seen in a DDR3 design. We've just examined the mutual inductance of the legs of an accordion trace and learned that there's not much effect on the timing. But what about the noise due to coupling effects of mutual inductance between two different signals? This noise is commonly referred to as crosstalk, a term created in the early days of the analog telephone industry. Back then, if two telephone wires were close enough together, you could sometimes hear another person talking on the other line, and thus the term crosstalk was invented. At this time, I would like to point out that mutual inductance is not the only coupling effect in a PCB layout, but since it is usually the largest influence, I'll focus on it during my discussions. Crosstalk due to mutual inductance can be visualized as a distributed network of transformers along the path of the two traces. A changing current in one side of the transformer induces a current flow in the other side, proportional to the percentage of mutual inductance. Thus, there will be more current generated when either the current changes faster and/or when there is more mutual inductance. Obviously, the change in current will be caused by the operation of the devices themselves, but the mutual inductance is determined by the proximity of the traces and thus can be analyzed and modified if necessary. You might be aware of the best practice rule of thumb that states the spacing between sensitive traces should be at least 2 times the trace width and more if possible. Unfortunately, this takes up a lot of valuable real estate on the PCB, and we are almost never able to actually have this much space between traces. So once again, we need to turn to simulation and signal integrity analysis to determine if our final routing will pass muster. To examine the effects of spacing on crosstalk, I've created two designs with parallel traces between the devices. The trace width is my usual 15 mils, and the first design has about that same distance between the traces. The second design increases the spacing to 30 mils, representing our 2x best practice scenario. Up until this point, we have been using our S parameters to examine the transmitted and reflected energy of a trace. As it turns out, S parameters have a whole lot of other information about the board, including allowing us to calculate the percentage of cross-coupling between traces. Using Cadence Power SI, we can display this cross-coupling in a form similar to our transmitted and reflected energies. Here is the graph for our first design with 1x spacing. As you see, the crosstalk starts off at zero for DC signals and increases as our frequency gets higher. Zooming into our target frequency range, we see that the percentage of crosstalk is almost 6%. This is a pretty significant amount of crosstalk. Here is the time domain analysis of the same design, zoomed in to show the noise effects. I'm plotting the aggressor voltage in blue and the victim trace voltage in red. You can see that there is rather significant noise being generated on the victim trace whenever there is a signal transition on the aggressor. After simulating my second design with a trace spacing of 30 mils, I've plotted the result on the same graph as that of the 15 mil spacing. As you can see, there is a significant decrease in the cross-coupling percentage. In fact, it's down to almost 0.4% as compared to 6% for the first design. That's a pretty amazing change, and thus illustrates why a spacing of 2x the trace width is a good rule of thumb. In the interest of time, I'm not going to do a 3x simulation, but you can guess that the crosstalk is going to be almost totally non-existent. The previous comments referred to the crosstalk in the frequency spectrum. When I plot the time domain simulation results for both cases, we can also see how the noise level on the victim trace has been reduced, but not quite as dramatically. Here, the 1x spacing is in red and the 2x spacing is in green. However, we can still draw the conclusion that while the rule of thumb spacing of 2x the trace width will usually give us acceptable levels of crosstalk, in many cases, this separation is just not possible due to routing constraints. Once again, we see the need for a board level simulation to determine the actual levels of crosstalk going on with the final design, and using these results to decide if routing changes need to be made. So far, in all of our design cases, we have been using only one routing layer, which is of course not very realistic for actual designs. Vias must be used to transition signal traces between the layers. Fabrication dimensions and functional design requirements typically govern the construction of a via. The primary parameters are the via hole size, pad sizes, and clearance or annular rings. Secondary parameters include plating thickness, via filling material, and via in pad concerns. However, it would be nice to know what effects these dimensions have on signal integrity. How can we change them to mitigate any potential problems and still allow for routing and fabrication? I've created a variation on my original ideal routing case in order to add in a via in the middle of the trace. In order to use only one via, I had to move the DDR3 chip to the bottom of the board. This is indicated here by the blue trace and blue footprint. If I zoom into the design, you can see the via connecting the red and blue traces. I'm using a 15 mil via pad to match the trace width and an 8 mil drill. The green ring here represents the clearance annulus on the reference plane. Since I also want to have as consistent an impedance as possible, I'm also using a rather unrealistic three-layer PCB. This gives me a single reference plane for both the top and the bottom routing layers. I've adjusted the dielectric thickness as well in order to maintain my 40 ohm trace impedance. After running the simulations, we see that the S parameters look very much like the original design case. However, there are some slight differences, which are more evident when I overlay the new S parameters with the original design. As you can see, while the transmission amplitude stays almost the same, there is more reflected energy than with the ideal case. This verifies my assertion earlier that changes in trace impedance cause more reflections. As always, it helps to see how these changes affect our time domain signals. The voltage at the DDR3 chip is shown here in blue and seems to have about the same shape as the ideal case. And in fact, when I overlap the ideal waveforms, they were exactly the same. Let me remind you that this design was intended to be an ideal use of a VIA, and thus will have the most minimal impact on the signal integrity. In a more realistic situation, we would have a multi-layer PCB board that would add more length to the VIA, as well as other factors such as additional signals and planes in proximity to this VIA. To emulate a thicker PCB without changing my other design parameters, I increased the middle copper reference plane to 20 mils thick. This is yet another unrealistic board design, but it serves to increase the length of my VIA tube. After simulation, we find that the reflected energy is increased even more, as we would expect if the trace impedance had changed. The transmitted energy, however, is staying about the same. We can see this even better when I overlay the S parameters again. Once again, though, in the time domain, there is almost no noticeable change in the waveforms. Let's try one more variation in our design. In addition to increasing the VIA length by making the PCB thicker, let's increase the drill diameter and the pad size as well. Here you see the result with a 20 mil hole size and a 30 mil pad size. The green ring is the clearance around the inner reference plane and is 60 mils in diameter. After simulating this design, we're starting to get some fun results. As you can see in the S parameter graph, we're starting to get some interesting resonant conditions due to the geometry of the VIA. However, since they are above our target frequency range of 2 GHz, I'm not all that worried about them right now. In this graph, I've overlaid all three VIA design cases as well as the ideal routing case. If we focus on the frequency range below 2 GHz, the main difference is an increase in the reflected energy at the upper frequency range and a slight decrease in the transmitted energy, as the VIA geometry has more of an effect on the trace impedance. In the time domain, we once again only notice a slight change in the signals. I've zoomed in on the end of one transition here to show just how little this effect is. Here, the red trace is the large VIA and the green trace is the ideal routing case. So in conclusion, we can see that VIAs do change the trace impedance and thus will have some effect on the signal integrity. However, other than trying to minimize the use of VIAs in general, the only way to truly know how much the signal integrity is affected is to do a full board level simulation of the final design. In this webinar, we examined a variety of different designs and layout scenarios, starting with the simplest ideal route that I could devise and adding in more and more complex routing paradigms. I use simulations in both the frequency and time domains to demonstrate the effects these different routing paradigms might have on the integrity of a signal. I would like to emphasize that all of the design cases I presented today were artificially created to demonstrate a specific routing case and its associated signal integrity effects. So even if we found that some of these effects may seem small or insignificant, remember that a real-world design will have an aggregate of all of these design cases and more. And thus, the overall signal integrity issues of the design will be more than the sum of its parts. I think that there are two main conclusions we can reach based on the analyses of these design studies. Even if you don't know it yet, signal integrity issues exist in all of your high-speed designs, and they will only get more critical as time goes on. And the only way to determine the actual effects of these signal integrity issues is to perform board-level simulations of the final design. I would like to note that in the course of this webinar, I was presenting the simulation results at a fast and furious rate, but there was still a significant amount of work done in preparation and simulation, even for these relatively simple design cases. As you may recall, my workflow involved the use of three major pieces of software, as well as some smaller utility programs, including some that I wrote myself. And while this is a not insignificant investment in both time and money, I cannot emphasize enough the importance of being able to perform signal integrity analysis on your designs, and strongly suggest that you look into the matter if you plan on doing high-speed designs in the future. We at 9.Connects would be happy to help you in this endeavor. We have for years both used and provided training for the Altium toolset, and we have a strategic partnership with Cadence that gives us access to both their simulation tools and their technical support. We also have a lot of experience in all aspects of high-speed design. In summary, I'd like to again provide a list of the design cases I presented in today's webinar. In part two of this webinar series, I'll be looking at some of the more advanced layout paradigms, as well as the signal integrity issues involved with a complete FPGA DDR3 design. If I have time, I will also try to touch on some PDN analysis issues, but this may end up being a webinar on its own. Okay, at this point, I'd like to do our third and final polling question. Relevant for what you need, that warms my heart to no end. So I am now, at this point, going to turn it back over to Paul.
All right, well, thank you very much. So you are here for a reason, and the reason you're here is that more than likely, like us, you probably put off signal integrity for quite a while. You've got enough on your plate, and you know, it's just one of those things that you know you're going to have to deal with, and hopefully you realize it's going to have to probably happen sooner than later. Secondly, you know, yes, you may need to get into it, but where do you start with it? Right? Do you look at videos? Do you read articles on it? Do you try to power your way through a tool? So we wanted to put together something that explained things in logical steps. And number three, probably the reason here is to determine what you might or might not need for your design flow. So we at 9.connects, as you hopefully know, we are a jack of all trades when it comes to PCB layouts and the whole process. So we do provide services above and beyond just simply training in Altium Designer tools. We do services for a lot of other things, such as thermal analysis, which was our presentation last month. We also do design for manufacturing. So we've had people come to us asking, hey, can you assist us making sure that what we're going to put together will be manufacturable? Library management, which is happens to be my forte, and we'll be doing something like that here in the near future for one of our webinars. And of course, signal integrity, which is what Tom talked about here today. But what about just signal integrity? Well, if you want to learn some tools, obviously Tom has gotten well-versed in Cadence, but we do have other individuals who know ANSYS and Mentor as well. Also a source to consult. So maybe you do have the tools, but you want a little bit of a guidance as to how to use these tools to their best abilities. And lastly, maybe you want an independent review of your board. Yes, you can do it, but you'd like to have somebody outside of your organization take a look at it, and we can assist with that as well. So with that, for more information, feel free to take a look at our website at 9.connects.com.